I want to put a tag on this text and for the next few moments, preach on the topic. This is my story. This is my story. Pray with me. Father, thank you so much for your grace and mercy. We thank you, Lord, that you love us more than anything. And that love has been extended towards us. And we just, Father, just want to give it back to you. And so, Lord, I pray that you would hide me behind your cross, that I may not be seen, but that you be seen and lifted up. And that at the end, that all that's been said and done, we will walk out of here with our heads up high of our story. And we will also know that you are with us, guiding us, keeping us, and protecting us. And this we pray in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. You really don't know what people are going through just by looking at them. You could be the life of the party, but on the inside, you are a suffering saint. You could wake up on top of the world and then go to sleep with the world on top of you. Somebody said, if I take one step forward, it only feels like I'm taking two steps back. Because nevertheless, one moment you are up, and the next moment you can be down. Because if you're not careful, this life that we live can absolutely push you to the limit where you feel like you are on the edge. Some of y'all are not feeling me like I need you to, so I'm going to quote that urban poet and poetic genius and scholar by the name of Grandmaster Flash. I know y'all are holy, and y'all don't listen to that, but didn't Grandmaster said, don't push me, because I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head. It's like a jungle sometimes, so it makes me wonder how I keep from going under. Yes, life can make you wonder, how in the world do you keep from going under? Nevertheless, do I have a witness up in here that every now and then, when it feels like things are going for you, that all of a sudden it can feel like every odd is against you? That could leave you wondering and questioning, what's working for me is worldly working against me. Let me break it down for you like this. The other day I had went to one of my favorite stores to return a shirt. And so I figured that I had to return the shirt before I started shopping because I figured, hey, I don't want nobody to think that I'm stealing this shirt. So I said, hey, I know my skin color. I know how things go. So I said, I'm going to return the shirt before I start shopping. And so as I'm standing on the line and as I'm about to return the shirt, I noticed that people in front of me are completing transaction after transaction after transaction. Only to my discovery that as I get to the front of the line, the young lady behind the register has a puzzled look on her face. She begins to tell me as she's looking at the computer that there is something wrong happening inside the store. I shoot back and say, I would like to return this shirt that I bought so that I can go and do something else. The girl looks at me, she says, I'm sorry, sir, but the system is down. The system is down right now. You can't return your shirt. There I am perplexed. I'm saying, hold up. The system worked for the other people before me. Why is it down as soon as I get to the front? She said, sir, I'm sorry. We've been having internet issues all day, and we can't return your shirt. Why? Because the system is down. Y'all not feeling me like I need you to, but check this out. Look at this. As I am standing there, and I have to wait because the system is down, there are other people who have completed their transaction. They are doing what they need to do, but I'm stuck like Chuck in a bad situation. Why? Because the system is down. Nevertheless, the people who are shopping around me could care less about my predicament because why? The system worked for them, but the system was down for me. Am I preaching to somebody up in here today? Haven't you ever noticed that in our yet-to-be United States of America that there is a system that works for other people, but as soon as I get to the line, the system is down. Y'all ain't feeling me like I need you to. The system is down. I guess I gotta preach this thing a little bit more. That's what life is like for black and brown people in America. The system is down when you have blatant economic disparities. The system is down when you have schools and communities that are prison pipelines. The system is down when your lifespan is contingent upon your zip code. The system is down when you have a president who stood up on a platform yesterday as he address police officers and encourage them to be more violent than they already are. Ain't it insane how in 6 months we have watched diplomacy, decency, and dignity go right out the door, and instead we have replaced it with xenophobic rhetoric, scheming, underhanded, backstabbing, foul-mouthed, bully pulpit politics. The system is not working. So I'm gonna hang out here for a little bit. I'm gonna get up out your face. I see the timer right there. Because in our text this afternoon, we read about a young man who was away from home and living in the mountains, cutting and hurting himself, full of many demons. He's living on the bottom. The system is not working. The system, the young man sent him to live in the mountains because nobody else wanted to deal with him anymore. His teachers looked at him and figured that he would amount to nothing, so we had low tolerance for him. In other words, he would run up and down, foaming at the mouth, slashing himself with stones. And since they did not know what to do with him, they decided to lock him up because they felt like they could not control him, and they deemed him as non-functional in the world that we live in today. And the same thing occurs in our society, because society has answers for reckless young people. Instead of rehabilitating them, their answer is to lock them up and throw them in prison, send them away so that we could forget about them. Instead of training and teaching them, the answer is we got a room for you in a gated community, and we will give you a job that pays either below minimum wage or you will get no wages at the end of the day. And so the Bible describes this young man as someone who spends his nights and days hurting himself. Why? Because he's going out of his mind. And let me park here parenthetically. When you are disconnected from God, you engage in behavior that is destructive. See, I don't care who you are. I don't care how big your Bible is. I don't care how circumference of your hat is. The further you stray from God, the more detestable and unthinkable things and thoughts you begin to have, but you don't see it while you're doing it. That's why when you come into relationship with Christ and you look back over your life, you begin to say, if it wasn't for the mercy and the goodness of God, I don't know where I would have been. You begin to think about all the things you used to do and who you used to do it with and what you were doing and who you were zooming, and your life cries out, my soul cries out, hallelujah, because thank God for saving me. And so further along in the text, the word tells us that Jesus stepped on the mountain and the demon-possessed man ran to Jesus, bowed down before him and begged Jesus and said, this is not our time to be tormented. And so can I stop here to simply remind you of what kind of power you have you working with? The text say that demons run and bow down before him and ask him not to be tortured. See, I don't know if you ever read this story, but we just highlighted the fact that he was sent to the mountains because no one could control him. And now demons, supernatural beings, are bowing down and worshiping God. They are basically saying, we know who you are. We know what you're about. We know what you do. We know power belongs to you, and you can wipe us out right now. But according to the scriptures, the demons say it is not time for us to die. Demons recognize the deity of Jesus Christ and recognize the awesome rulership and the power of the God we serve. And just to get you to say amen and to stand up in church is like pulling teeth, but demons recognize Jesus. See, I don't know about you, but you ain't got to push me, prick me, or poke me to acknowledge a God that can turn water into wine, a God who can part a sea, a God who can put a line on a fast, a God who can cool a fiery furnace, and a God who woke me up this morning and started me on my way. I don't come to church to get entertained. I come to church to give God praise. So Jesus, with all power, the HNIC head Nazarene in charge, our Lord, leader, and liberator, says this, asks the demon, what is your name? Jesus commanded the demon to come out of him, because my problem is not with the young man, my problem is with the demons. You see, I'm not going to blame this young man for his behavior, but I'm going to blame demonic influences and strongholds for the reason why he's acting like that or why she's dressing like that. You see, aren't you glad that when you were out of your mind that Jesus still dealt with you instead of judging you? Ain't it crazy that how the most oppressive institution on earth is the church? I have seen people who have come to church who have been scarred by the church, and most people who leave the church, they don't leave because of doctrinal issues. They leave because people can't keep in mind their business and keep talking about how you look and what you used to do.
Always got folk up in church always talking about places I used to go, I don't go no more. And things I used to do, I don't do no more. No places you used to go, you can't go because they all closed. And things you used to do, you can't do them no more because you too old to do them. And if you could do them, you still would. Sitting up in here, you wasn't always wearing long skirts and big hats. Well, let me pull out a photo album of you. Talk about what you used to do. No, what Jesus does, Jesus deals with the problem that you had. Jesus asked the demon, what is your name? Demon responds by saying, our name is Legion because we are many. We roll deep. And not just one of us, but there are many of us inside of him. We live in here. When one of us moved in, we decided to move more demons inside of him. And truth be told, I don't know the real you, but there is a truth in that for many of us, that there is more than us inside of us. I got more than me inside of me. Demon responds by saying that our name is Legion. Because every now and then, that's why you could be in church singing praises to God, but your mind is somewhere else. Because I've discovered that the enemy is the inner me. It is not always the devil tempting me to do something. It is me that is at enmity with God. Because I got more than me inside of me. So Jesus said, what's your name? Demon responds, say, our name is Legion. Now, Legion was not the young man's name, but it was his problem. And the reason why some of us struggle the way we do is because when God asks us, what is your name, we don't want to identify the problem that we're dealing with. You will never overcome your demon until you identify it for what it is. Name your demon. Is it drinking, fornication, pornography, anger, cussing, cheating, lying? Whatever your demon is, name it so God can deal with it. But here's something deeper. Mark is one of my favorite books because Mark always writes in double entendres. And Mark always presents a story that is deeper than what's on the surface. And so by Mark using the name Legion, he is also describing Roman occupational forces. You understand that Rome was controlling Israel. And so by this young man's story, it is his testimony of how all Israelites were feeling under Roman oppression. They were colonized. And the young man is calling himself something that he is not. Because colonialism creates an atmosphere of living death, which fosters a systemic breakdown of human personality. And people who are colonized are always conquered. And so in reality, when they ask the same question, who am I? Since they don't know who they are, they identify with every name that the conqueror gives them. And so what the Bible, what Mark is saying here, is that this young man has oppressive thinking because Rome is in his dome. And therefore, instead of saying his real name, he is calling himself what the oppressor calls him and saying that he is wild in thoughts. Can I preach this thing right here? We are not monkeys. We are not the N word, the B word, the H word, lazy or stupid. I will not claim a name that God has not given to me. I will not subject myself to a history that only wants to tell me about my slavery and not my royalty. I will not be a second class citizen. I am somebody because I'm stamped with the image of God. Because Song of Solomon says, I am dark but lovely. I'm as beautiful as Zipporah. I'm as strong as Ebed-Melech. I'm as generous as Simon the Seron. Excellence is part of who I am. I did not have to borrow it from somebody. There is excellence in my DNA. It is in my DNA. It is in my DNA. I know y'all feeling me. I'm gonna go Kendrick Lamar on you. It is in my DNA. I got loyalty, got royalty inside my DNA. I got hustle, I got ambition flow inside my DNA. I was born like this, this one like this, immaculate control. I transform like this, perform like this, was Yeshua's new weapon. It is in my DNA. Oh no, it's gonna get gooder. I'm almost done. Jesus says, I gotta do something for this young man. I gotta switch his DNA. Jesus looks at him and says, this gonna take an inside job. We're gonna deal with this. This gonna take an inside job. When this young man approaches Jesus, Jesus heals him. He tells the demons, y'all gotta get out of here. He removes the demons from his life. Jesus then goes, and the Bible says that the demons asked for Jesus not to kill him, but send him into the pigs. A lot of us are the way we are because we keep feeding pigs. and we won't get rid of the pigs in our lives. If you're a parent, you probably have this book or you have seen it, and it's called If You Give a Pig a Pancake. My daughter has this book, and you've probably seen variations of this same thing, but it's a wonderful book. And the book says this: if you give a pig a pancake, chances are he's going to want syrup. And if you give him syrup, chances are if you give him syrup, he's going to want a fork, and he's going to continue and go on. But I realized that there is something powerful about that book, because I've discovered that for some of us in relationships, it is like that. Because if you give a pig a touch, chances are he's going to want a hug. And if you give a pig a hug, chances are he's going to want a kiss. And if you give a pig a kiss, chances are he's going to invite you to the pig pen. And chances are if you go to the pig pen, you're going to end up catching something that you did not have in the first place, because you gave a pig a touch. You got to get rid of the pigs in your life. That was for my other crowd. That's not for y'all. But the word tells us that after Jesus called the demons to come out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the pigs ran into the water. But did you know that this is a kosher community? What is swine doing hanging out there? Why are Jews raising pigs? By Jews keeping and feeding the pigs, according to one minister, it represented an underground economy. Because wherever there is poverty, there is also shady business going on. Pigs are being fed in our communities, and this has to deal with your theme, Summer in the City. You see, our job is to open our eyes and identify the pigs in our communities that are not helping us, but are hurting us and our children. Payday loan advance shops, pawn shops, cheap milk liquor stores, processed food store, mama's fried chicken. Everything that is created to exploit and destroy poor people are in their communities. And it's up to the church to not just simply engage in charitable events, but we've got to be committed to breaking down systems and structures that exist to keep poor people poor. And so by Jesus cleaning out the pigs, he was cleaning up the community. African-American women are the biggest monopolizers of product. African-American women, we are the biggest consumers of weave, of product, and all that stuff. But yet still, we have no monopoly on those things. In other words, what we do, we are glad to walk up in somebody else's shop who sets up their business inside our community as they follow us, as we all go around, as we buy our weave, as we buy our product, and they will follow us like a thief. But yet still, we will never stop to say, how in the world do I own the supplies that I buy and sell it back to my own community? I know why you're not saying amen, because you was up in there Friday buying your product so you could look good up in here at the church. But how is it that we allow people to move into our communities, take money from our people, and take it out of our community and invest it in their own? The job of the church is to clean up the community. So by Jesus getting rid of the pigs, he was messing with their money. And so after he messed with their money, he got rid of them. And so I want you to get this point. Jesus cleaned up the guy. God fixes you internally, which has an effect on you externally, so that you can be used outwardly. In other words, Jesus saying, I cannot empower you to be a spokesman for me until I fix you internally so that you could be used outwardly. God dealt with the demons that were controlling him, and then he empowers you to be a witness to those who are trying to oppress you. Before, he was identified by his struggle, but now he's got a new identity in Christ. Verse 19, the Bible says that the demon-possessed man begged to go with Jesus, and Jesus says no. Pause right here. He asks Jesus, can I be one of your disciples? Then Jesus says no. I'm praying, God, to give me a breakthrough, but Jesus says no. God will sometimes say no to your requests. God will sometimes, when you pray to him, he will deny your requests. But the God you serve will never give you a no without an instead. All right? I'm gonna stay there. God doesn't always allow you to do what you want to do, but it's safe to say that God isn't always going to answer everyone's prayers, but God will say no sometimes because he wants you to say yes to the plan for his life. In other words, don't ever put a period where God puts commas. The devil takes snapshots, but God writes motion pictures. Anybody old school in here, have you ever watched a cartoon, Conjunction, Junction, what's yo? I got a few people up in here. And everybody knows what a conjunction does. A conjunction is wonderful. You have and or a but. And a conjunction and, what does a conjunction and do? A conjunction and connects whatever comes before it to what comes after it. When you have the conjunction or does this. A conjunction says, the conjunction or says that you can have this or you can have that. You get the simultaneous option of choosing something. But whenever God puts a comma or the but inside of a sentence, this is what a but does. A but does this. A but takes whatever is in front of it and negates it and makes you look forward to whatever comes after it. In other words, a but always kicks the butt on what is before it so that you can look forward to whatever comes after it, because you get a comma and then you get a but. Because I don't know if there's anybody in here, but don't ever put a period where God puts commas, because weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. What's the other text? Satan desires to shift you like wheat, but I have prayed for you. I guess I'm like Sir Mix-a-Lot. I like big butts and I cannot lie, because every time God puts a but in my life, it makes me look forward to what's coming after it than what came before it in order to bless you. Y'all ain't feeling me like I need you to, so let me break this thing a little bit down for you. God gives you a word in season because he wants to show you something else. As a matter of fact, I think Pastor Tyler Stewart preached on this text when he talked about the shalom of the city. And then down in verse 13 where God says, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thoughts to give you peace, a future, and an expected end. That God gave them that word while they were in exile. Well, I broke down the word etymologically because I know y'all are an edumacated church and you have an edumacated pastor. And I looked at that text, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you. Remember the context of the text. They are in Babylonian exile. They are not at home. And so when God says, for I know the thoughts that I think, that word thoughts is invention. And so what God is basically saying, for I know the invention that I'm creating for you to bring you out of the situation that you are in. I love an invention. What is an invention? An invention is something that has never been created before, but I'm going to do it for you and blow your mind. And so what God is telling Israel is, I'm about to blow your mind. And God said, how I'm going to bring you out of your situation? For I know the invention that I think towards you. Now the word towards you is even better, because the word towards you is where we get the word weave. It's where we get the word weave. Weave. For I know the invention that I'm weaving for you. I thought you would have been shouting right there. Y'all acting like y'all don't know what a weave is. What is a weave? A weave is when you buy something from somebody to add to what you don't have to make it look like you got more than what you didn't have before so that you could do something. That's what a weave is, right? And so the God that you serve, he says, for I know the invention that I'm weaving for you to bring you out of your situation. Because God can take what you didn't have and add to what you don't have to make it look like you have more than what you did not have before. Because the God you serve is unbelievable how he brings you out of situations. Do I have a witness up in here? Sit down, sit down, sit down. It's going to get gooder. It's going to get gooder. Thank God that God says no and he opens up other doors. I told you there are sermons and stones and illustrations and everything. Because if God says, if the rocks can cry out, then I can talk to inanimate objects and they can give me a blessing as well. We are still staying on the same thing where God says no and he'll give you something better. I remember when I was working for Northeastern Conference, and we were in the conference office, and they do their youth convention in Connecticut. And I had checked into the hotel. They do it in January where it's cold, it is raining, and I was tired, and I just wanted to get to my room. So I checked into the room, and I had ran to the elevator. And as I'm running to the elevator with my bags, there are some kids that were on the elevator. And they had saw me running to the elevator, and guess what them little kids did? They had closed the elevator in front of my face. Them little minions, baby kids, I couldn't stand them right now. I was tired. I wanted to get inside of the elevator. But check this out. And you know how I know they did it on purpose? Because I heard them snickering like little. I heard them. I was going to say something else. I heard them snickering as they were going up. But when I looked at my paper, check this out. I was staying on the 14th floor. When I looked at the elevator had only went to the 8th floor. And so if I had ran on that elevator, I would have ended up on a level that I should not have been on. But there was an elevator behind it that was going to take me to a higher place. I'm so glad that God closed that door, because he opened up a better door for me. Somebody in here ought to thank God that he didn't give you that job. Somebody in here ought to thank God that he broke you up with that old Negro and that ain't your husband right now. Somebody ought to thank God that he broke you up from that sister, because at the end of the day, that was just a $500 weave on a 10-cent head, and you got a better girl right now who is doing something for you. Thank God for closing doors in your life. Whoa! All right, I gotta take my seat. I gotta take my seat. Now I'm gonna bring this thing home. I'm gonna bring it home right now. I'm gonna bring it home right now. God said no, and he opened up another door, and he sent him to Decapolis. Right? He sent him to Decapolis. He sent him back home. He sent him back home to go and tell his story. He says, look here, man, I could ask you to be with me. I already got 12 disciples, but I need you to go do something back in Decapolis. And so I broke down the word Decapolis, and I had to understand this. He went back to Decapolis and told his story. And the story was so powerful that it tore up the entire country, that people were blessed by him. And so I broke down that name, Decapolis, and I came up with two words. You see, Deca is Greek for 10, and Polis is Greek for city. And so in other words, he went back to 10 cities and he told his story, and his story turned the world upside down. That the story was so powerful that people from everywhere started praising Jesus and became followers of Jesus Christ because of this one man's story. And so I looked up the 10 cities that were in Decapolis. And now I didn't do something before, but I'm going to do it now. Mark, I'm pausing right here. Mark is a contemporary of Paul. And Paul, they would say that Mark gave Paul some of his stories, that Mark told Paul about Jesus Christ and some of the things that he did. Hold on to that. Put that in your pocket, because I'm going to break it down right here. Here are the 10 cities that the man went back and preached to. The 10 cities were Gerasa, Scythopolis, Hippos, Gadara, Pella, Philadelphia, Capitolius, Canatha, Raphana, and the capital city, Damascus. Preacher, what are you saying to me right now? You said that the gospel had grown so much in Damascus that there was an explosion of people. And did you say that Paul is giving John Mark his story in the Bible? And so if my brain doesn't fail me right now, but the last time I checked my Bible, there was a man by the name of Saul who was on his way to Damascus, to eager to kill and persecute and arrest those Christians. But on his way to Damascus, he was struck down by a bright light. Jesus knocked him off his horse, blinded him, and said, why are you persecuting me? And now we know there's Paul's conversion story, but all of this transpired because one demon-possessed young man had went back to Damascus and had preached the gospel of Jesus, which led Saul to get on his horse to go down to Damascus to kill those Christians. But Saul was converted because of Jesus, and that's why I stand here today, that you had better share your story. Because I don't care how bad your story is, because your story could lead to another story that brings somebody out of persecution. See, y'all are twisted. Y'all assume that just because Acts came after the book of Mark, that did not happen. But Paul, Saul, got his conversion story because one man shared his story. And so can I close this sermon out the best way I know how to? And I'm going to give you a shout right now, because I know and understand that it's because of your story that people will change. It's because of what God did for you that people will change. One of my favorite preachers is by the name of Samuel DeWitt Proctor. And Samuel DeWitt Proctor was a bad preacher during the Civil Rights Movement. And Samuel DeWitt Proctor would preach Jesus Christ and his righteousness until one day a school invited him to come and preach. And as he went up to the school to go and preach, the provost looked at him because he did not see Samuel DeWitt Proctor. And the provost had a very red neck. He was a redneck individual. And as he looked at Samuel DeWitt Proctor, he said, you ain't never gonna preach at this school. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you've done. But because you are a brown man in this Jim Crow segregation, you ain't gonna preach at this school unless it's over my dead body. Well, a few years had gone by, about 15 years, and the same school called and asked Samuel DeWitt Proctor to come back and preach. And Samuel DeWitt Proctor was hesitant about going and preach, but Samuel DeWitt Proctor said, any call from God is a call to go and preach. And so he went up to the school and he went down there to preach. And so as he's sitting on the platform, he looked at the current provost and he said, where is the old provost of this school? And the man looked at him and he leaned over and said, oh, that provost, he's been gone for a while, and he had spent so much money on this wonderful chapel that you are about to preach in right now. Samuel DeWitt Proctor said, it is a wonderful chapel. The provost looked at him and said, because he donated so much money and because he loved this school so much, we decided to bury his body underneath that pulpit about which you are about to preach. Samuel DeWitt Proctor said, you mean to tell me I'm about to preach over his dead body. Samuel the prophet got up and said, for God is a very present help in the time of trouble. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Share your story. Tell them this is my story. This is my song. I'm praising my Savior all the day long. Do I have two or three people in here? You got a story to tell. I was sinking deep in sin, far from a peaceful shore, but the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me, and now safe am I. Share your story. He that will come shall come and will not tarry. I know David Franklin ain't here, but I'm about to have a business meeting. I so move that Miracle City will share their story. Do I have a second to that motion? All in favor, get up on your feet and give God praise. This is my story. I'm praising God all the day long. Share your story.